Praise the Lord. I heard someone say, let us go into the house of the Lord. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. God is worthy this morning. Somebody didn't wake up this morning, but I'm so glad to be amongst the living. We just thank and praise God because he's worthy. He's worthy of all the honor, the glory, and the praise. And we just want to say thank you. Thank you, Lord.
Deserve the glory and the honor. We lift our hands in worship and we bless your holy name. You deserve the honor and the glory. We lift hands to worship and we bless your holy name, for you are great, you do miracles so great, there is no one else like you, there is no so
Thank you, Jesus. Giving the highest honor to the Lord Jesus and our God Almighty and the Lord Jesus Christ and His divine Holy Spirit. Thank you, Jesus. Just to be in the house of the Lord one more time. One more time. I have so much to be thankful for. I just praise His holy and righteous name. And you can, those who can, stand on your feet, lift your hands toward heaven, and let Him know, I came here to worship you. Came here to worship you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. You're so worthy. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. The room grew still as she made her way to Jesus. She stumbles through the tears that made her blind. She felt such pain, some spoke in anger. Her folks say there's no room here for your kind. But on she came through the shame that flushed her face, till at last she knelt before His feet. And though she said no word, everything she said was heard as she poured her love for the Master from her box of alabaster. I've come to pour my praise on Him like gold from Mary's alabaster box. Don't be angry if I wash His feet with my tears and dry them with my hair. You weren't there the night He found me. You did not feel what I felt when He wrapped His loving arms around me. And you don't know the cost of the oil in my alabaster box. I can't forget the way life used to be. I was a prisoner to the sin that held me bound. And I spent my days, all my life, without measure, and too little treasure, but I thought I found. But then one day, Jesus came to me, and He wrapped His love in the wonder of His touch. And now I'm giving back to Him all the praise He's worthy of. I've been forgiven, and that's why I love Him so much. Praise on Him like gold from Mary's alabaster box. Don't be angry if I wash His feet with my tears and dry them with my hair. Me. You did not feel what
don't know the cause.
Amen, amen.
Glory, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. My God, the cost of the oil in our alabaster box, hallelujah. Oh, that woman paid a heavy price by giving her very breasts to minister unto Jesus Christ. And we're thankful, amen, on this morning that we have this same opportunity to give our very breasts unto our Lord and our Savior, amen. We are so grateful and so thankful.
Yes, hallelujah.
Amen. For our Lord and our Savior Jesus Christ and everything that he's doing in and through our lives today. Yes, we are thankful and we are grateful this morning. Hallelujah. Glory
hallelujah.
To God.
Thank
hallelujah.
You, God.
Thank you,
thank
Jesus.
Thank you, God.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
He is worthy of all glory.
He is worthy.
He is worthy of all honor. Jesus yes. is worthy of all praise.
Yes, he is.
We rejoice in his holy and his righteous name. Truly, we thank the Lord this morning for giving us everything that pertains to life and godliness.
Yes, everything.
And we're just so thankful for each and every one of you that are joining in by way of our live services on this morning here at Love Fellowship Church or even by way of Facebook Live or YouTube. Amen. We're just so grateful.
Grateful.
Yes, I'm your host, Pastor Anthony Williams, and my lovely co-host, Pastor Renee, is with us again on today. And we're just thankful that we have this opportunity to wrap up our final edition of this series entitled yes. Kingdom Families. Amen.
Kingdom families.
We are grateful for the Word of God and we're grateful for the Spirit of the Living God living and dwelling on the inside of every born again believer. And Pastor Day, can you just simply say a word of prayer? Amen. Before we go into the text on this morning.
Yes. Father God, we just thank you on today, God. We thank you for kingdom families, oh God. We thank you, God, that you have made your word clear, oh God, that as believers, oh God, we are a part of the kingdom of God, the family of God.
Yes.
And therefore, we have access to everything that you've made available to us.
Hallelujah.
God, as the word go forth on today, oh God, we pray, oh God, that it will fall on good ground.
Yes.
And that people will see themselves the way you see them.
Yes.
The way you feel about them, oh God, that they will see themselves as part of the family. Family, oh God.
Hallelujah.
That they are not orphans, oh God, but they've been adopted into the family of God by love and righteousness through your son, Jesus Christ.
Yes.
So we thank you, God, on today, and it is in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. So let's open up by making a couple of key statements here. As we close out this series, we must understand and know, amen, as people that are connected to God, what we are entitled to. Amen.
Wow.
We've got to see ourselves the way Christ sees us. And if we can see ourselves the way Christ sees us, then guess what we can do? We can see our families
yes.
the way Christ sees our families. Amen.
Yes.
How many of you believe that we must see ourselves the way Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, sees us? And as we do that, amen, it will bless our families. Come on, Pastor Renee.
So Jesus sees us as a member of the family.
Yes.
And you know, when you're a member of the family, you get special treatment. Special treatment.
Amen.
You're just not just anybody. But when you are a member of the family, God says that you get special treatment. So we're going to go. Our first scripture is going to be in Galatians 3 and 28 and 29 in the Message Bible.
Yes.
So I'm going to give you a moment to get there. When you get there, say amen.
Amen.
Pastor there. Okay. Okay, it says, the Word of God says, in Christ's family, there can be no division into Jew and non-Jew, slave and free, male and female. Among us, you are all equal. That is, we are all in a common relationship, hallelujah, with Jesus Christ. Also, since you are Christ's family, then you are Abraham's famous descendant.
Wow.
Heirs according to the covenant promises.
Wow. Did you hear what Jesus, amen, is saying through the Apostle Paul?
Yes.
As the Apostle Paul wrote this letter to the church of Galatia, he says, in Christ's family,
yes,
out of the Message Bible, it reads, there is no division. Wow. So if there's no division in Christ's family, guess what? There ought be no division in our own families.
Our own
Amen.
Families.
There ought not be division in our marriages. There ought not be division between us and our children.
Right.
Because in Christ's family, there's no division.
No division.
There's neither Jew nor non-Jew, slave or free, male or female. In other words, everyone in Christ's family has equal access to the kingdom of God.
Yeah.
So the question ought to be, okay, how do I become a part of Christ's family? Well, it's very simple. You must be born again. Amen. Because to be a part of Christ's family means to be a part of the kingdom of God. And as we, amen, live our lives as individuals, we also must see ourselves as a part of a collective larger group, which is Christ's family or the kingdom of God. And when we do that, we ought to be able to see our families as a part of that as well. You say, well, Pastor Anthony, what if my children are not saved? Well, guess what? You ought to be speaking over their lives in your prayers, in your confessions, that they will too have a desire to be a part of Christ's family.
Right. And you got to live according to words God, according to the word of God in front of them.
Yes.
You can't live one way at home and then come to church and live another way.
Come on.
They have to see you as an example. You have got to be a living epistle in front of your children. They need to know that you are dependent on God. When you go through challenges, they need to see you praying. When you're going through challenges, they need to see you confessing the word of God. That's how we get our families to understand that they are part of a greater family, the family of God.
So what we're doing today as we open up is we're seeing ourselves as a part of Christ's family.
Yes.
And we're uncovering what that means and then what are the benefits associated with being a part of Christ's family. Mm-hmm. Amen.
Yes.
See, with any family membership, there ought to be benefits. In a family, there ought to be benefits. Come on.
Yes. An example I would like to give is that if you have a membership at the Y, say you have a family membership. If you have a family membership, every member of your family is entitled to the benefits of that membership. They can't say, oh, well, you can't use the Y today because your name is not on the roll. No, my family's name is on the roll. So you have access to everything that's available at the Y simply through family membership. So there are benefits in being part of the family of God.
Pastor Renee,
we have the advantage.
So going back to your YMCA, amen, mm-hmm, example. Mm-hmm. So if a teenager is a part of a family and the parents have the membership at the Y,
yes,
but the mom or the dad is not able to take the child to the Y, but somebody else takes them, mm-hmm, are they still able to access the pool and the weight room?
Yes.
Now, why is that?
Because they have the family membership plan.
Come on. So if they have the family membership plan, whether or not the parent is physically present with them, mm-hmm, when they go to the YMCA, mm-hmm, they still have access. They still have rights.
Yes.
They still can get in the pool.
They still can get in the pool.
So we're not physically present with Jesus Christ.
Come
in
on.
Other words, Jesus, amen, is no longer walking the earth.
Come on, that's good.
But the benefits of what Jesus did while he walked on the earth is still available to the members of Christ's family.
Yes.
Oh, somebody
yes
ought to give
yes
God praise for that.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
We ought to rejoice in the Lord for that. Because, amen, we don't, just because we're not physically present with Christ doesn't mean the benefits go away. Hallelujah.
My God.
Ah, you got to make sure your name is on the membership card. Hallelujah. See, if your name is not on the, if you don't have the membership card, then you don't get the benefits. You can't swim in the pool. You can't go to the weight room. You can't do the exercise classes. Uh-huh. You can't go to the gym or all the other things that the Y have to offer. But I submit to you that we're not just talking about the Y. We're talking about something greater than the YMCA. Greater. God has kingdom benefits for our families that are greater than getting pool and the spa and the weight room and playing ball on the basketball court. God's benefits of healing, God's benefits of peace, God's benefits of joy, God's benefits of holiness and righteousness, God's benefits of truth are available. His benefits of favor are available to all who are members of Christ's family. This is what Paul was trying to convey to the church of Galatia, because they had the wrong mindset. They were a body of believers, families that were assembled together with wrong mindset.
Yes.
And Paul said, wait a minute, it's not about the law. It's not about works. It's not about so much what you do, but it's what Christ did for you.
Yes.
See, Christ did some things for our families. Yes. That even we as parents cannot do for our own children.
Yes, that's right.
And for our families. And it is important, amen, that we understand that we are heirs with Christ.
Yes.
We are joint heirs with Christ.
Yes.
And not only that, but we are also heirs to the promises that God made to Abraham.
Yes, yes.
Because
in the last part of that, it talks about us being the descendants of Abraham.
Yeah.
So if we are descendants of Abraham, the way God blessed Abraham, we're entitled to that.
Yes.
We have access to that.
Yes. One translation said we're heirs. We're Abraham's seed. Mm-hmm. And when you think about it from that perspective, an heir is a benefactor. An heir reaps the benefits of the one that bestows those benefits on them. So the heir receives an inheritance.
Yes.
The heir receives something that they didn't work for, but they get it because of their connection to the heiress.
Yes.
See, Jesus is the heiress. Amen. God is the heiress. He's the one that confers to the heir the benefits.
Yes.
Or the rewards.
Yes. My father recently passed away, and he had a will written out on who would get what. And one thing he left his collection of cars to my son. Jonathan didn't work for those cars. Jonathan didn't collect those cars. But they were written down that he may inherit them even though he didn't work for them.
So he gets
the benefit of a collection of cars simply by being a member of the family.
Now going back to the YMCA example. So... You could have a family membership to the YMCA, and the family drives by the YMCA, but they never pull into the parking lot.
Wow.
They pull into the parking lot, but they never get out of the car.
Wow. Wow, we do that.
Now,
so
will
much.
The pool come to them? Will the weight room come to them?
Mm-mm.
What do they have to do? They have to do something.
Yes.
They have to access.
Yes, they got to enter in.
They got to enter in. They got to access
what's
already been made available to them.
Uh-huh.
See, the pool is already in the Y. The weight room is already in the Y. The track, the indoor track, it's all available, and it can benefit our overall health and wholeness. But if we never get out of the car, even though we have a membership card, if we never, my God, go into the front doors of the Y, then guess what? If we never stick our toes in the pool, we will never get the benefit of what is being provided.
Available. That's right. That's right.
If we never understand what the Word of God says about our families, we'll never reap the benefits that God has for our families. God is not a respecter of person. That's what Paul was saying. They were in the church in Galatia. They had a distinction. Well, this person is blessed, but it didn't seem like I'm blessed.
Mm-hmm.
And Paul said, no, it's not a, God is no one of division. Jesus is no respecter of person. You got to access.
Everybody has access.
But if you don't be intentional.
Intentional.
In the word of God, understanding.
Yes.
What you've been made an heir to,
come on.
You never access it. And even when you know what you've been made an heir to, guess what? You still got to access it.
Yes.
Access is the key to breakthrough. Hallelujah.
Yes. Yes.
Access is the key to the abundance. Huh? Access is the key to the overflow. We must access mm-hmm. what God has prepared.
Yes.
Yes. Come on.
Come on, let's talk about Abraham and God's promises toward him.
Yes.
Because he promised Abraham that he would be a blessing to all the families of the earth.
Yes.
In Genesis 12, verses 1 through 3, in the King James Version, it says this. Listen what it says. It says, now the Lord had said unto Abram, get thee out of thy country and from thy kindred and from thy father's house unto a land that I will show thee. And I will make of thee a great nation.
Uh-huh.
And I will bless thee and make thy name great. And thou shalt be a blessing.
Wow.
And I will bless them that bless thee and curse him that curse thee. And in thee shall all the families of the earth be blessed.
So I have a question for you. Was Abraham blessed before he connected with God? Make you think, doesn't it? Was he blessed before he connected with God?
Nope.
No, he wasn't. The Bible says here, now the Lord said unto Abram,
yes.
or Abraham, get thee out of thy country, from thy kindred, and from thy father's house, unto a land that I will show thee, and I will make thee a great nation, and I will bless thee. So the blessing didn't come until the connection came.
Right.
See, without a connection to God, you can't be a benefactor of the blessings of God. Mm-hmm. See, what God has requires a connection. But not only a connection, but it required obedience.
Wow.
It may seem like a hard thing that God was telling Abram or Abraham. He was telling Abram or Abraham to separate. Wow. Mm-hmm. He said, get out of the familiarity of your country. Get away from the familiarity of your father's house or your distant cousins and kinfolk. And I will give you a new land and I will be your God and your people shall be my people. Abraham had to not only connect with the blessing, but he had to be obedient to the voice of God to receive the blessing.
Yes.
Guess what? We have to do the same thing. We
got
to be able to connect with the blessing.
Yes.
And then we must be obedient to God's command and instruction in his word in order to receive the blessing. So, amen, if we're not receiving the blessings or we feel like we're not blessed, maybe you got a connection problem.
Because it's not about connecting to the blessing.
Mm-hmm.
It's about connecting to God.
Right. And if you say, well, no, I'm connected to God. Well, maybe you got an obedience or an application problem.
My God.
See, you got to do a check down. If your cell phone is not working and you can't figure it out and it's stopping you from doing what you want to do on your phone, you go to the manufacturer. You go to the store. When you go to the store, they do a check down. They start checking one step, next step, next step. And if they can't get all of that, and if all the check downs are not done, they say, okay, we need to do a factory reset.
Uh-huh.
And they do a whole reset. So, my God, in your check down, if you say, okay, my connection with God is strong, I'm praying, I'm reading the word, I'm meditating on the word of God each and every day. Okay, then your application, all right? I feel like my application is strong. My God, I'm studying, I'm meditating. Well, maybe you're missing it somewhere. Maybe you need to do a reset. Hallelujah. Maybe, my God, you need to go back to God and say, I think I'm praying right. I think I'm reading enough. I think my connection is strong. But what do you think, God? See, that's the factory reset.
Yes. Hashtag
we're
reset.
So quick to speak for God, but Abraham didn't speak for God. He listened to what God said.
Yes. Mm.
We're so quick to say, yeah, my prayer right is strong. My prayer life is strong. Yeah, yeah, my word life is strong. I'm studying the word. We're so quick to speak for God. But Abraham didn't do that. He let God speak for himself. Perhaps we need to do a factory reset.
Yes.
And let God start speaking to us.
Yes.
Instead of us telling everybody or telling ourselves what God is saying.
Yes.
See, Abraham let God speak. Mm-hmm. That's a good, good set of instruction to the families today. Mm-hmm. Let God do more speaking to you in 2021.
Come on. We want to hear
you.
You
may think you got it right and you know what's right and you're doing it the right way. But God may see something you don't see.
Come on.
And this whole message today is about seeing it the way Christ sees it.
Yes.
Not the way we see it. Seeing it the way God sees it. Not the way we see it. So the blessing, amen, is people get real spooky about the blessing. We call a lot of things blessings. But if we give a working definition, the blessing is the empowerment to prosper in every area and every aspect of our lives. The empowerment. God wants to empower you to prosper. Amen. See, when we boil it down to what the blessing is, it's an enablement. It's an empowerment to prosper. Then Abraham was empowered by God through his connection to God and through his obedience to God to prosper in every area and every aspect of his life.
Yes. And let me add this little nugget here for FYI. You being blessed is not to raise your standard of living. It is to raise your standard of giving.
Ah, come on. That's good.
Because he told Abram, you're going to be blessed to be a blessing. So what good is it if we obtain the blessing and the favor of God and we're the only thing we're thinking about is raising our own standard of living. Mm. We're thinking about what kind of house we should have. We're going to get more clothes. We're going to get more weave. No, it's not about that.
Now, you said weave.
Weave, hair.
Okay. And not weed. Amen. Let's make that
clear. No, not weed. Weave. Weave.
Come on, we got to make that clarification,
okay.
Amen. She said hair, amen.
Hair.
All right, come on.
Okay.
But yes,
we're blessed to be a blessing so that we're in a position to give. I am focused on being debt free so that I can give more to the kingdom.
Yes.
Not so I can get more things. Yeah, I got a list of things that I want done at the house, but I'm not willing to do that and not be able to give to the kingdom.
Wow, wow, wow. So Abraham, remember this about Abraham. Abraham was before the law. He predated the law of Moses.
Yes.
Moses was the lawgiver. Mm-hmm. Moses was not yet born yet. We're coming out of the days of Noah, amen, where Noah found grace. And now we're in the days of Abraham. So Abraham was before Noah, before Moses, but the Ten Commandments were given to Moses. So everything that God was saying to Abraham predated or preceded the law. That's important to understand.
Yes.
So whatever Abraham did and whatever God said for Abraham to do, it was not tied to the law.
Yeah.
It was tied to grace and faith. Mm-hmm. It was tied to God's love for Abraham, just like it was for Noah.
Yes.
Noah found grace because of his obedience to God. God loved Noah. He said, I'll never destroy man in the manner that I did in the flood. Mm-hmm. So Abraham was in that same lineage like Noah was. The reset had already been done.
Yes.
The wiping out of the earth had already been done, and so now the repopulation of the earth was taking place, and God was saying, okay, after Noah, now I'm finding another seed called Abraham.
Come on.
Abraham now was considered the seed that God was going to use to repopulate the earth with families.
Come on.
And that he and his seed would be blessed to be a blessing.
Mm-hmm.
And we just read that if we are Christ's seed, then we're heirs to the promises that Christ made to Abraham, that God made to Abraham. So we're getting into that. The first promise was the blessing.
Yes.
The empowerment to prosper, the enablement to prosper. Amen. God, when we enter into a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ, when we receive Jesus as our personal Lord and Savior, there's a conferring of the blessing or the empowerment or the enablement to prosper in our lives and in our families.
Yes.
But then God says something else as he continues on in the blessing. Come on, let's look at it in Genesis chapter 15, verses 1 through 6.
In the New Living Translation, it says, "Sometime later, the Lord spoke to Abram in a vision and said to him, 'Do not be afraid, Abram, for I will protect you, and your reward will be great.'"
So he says that I will protect you, Abram.
Yeah.
He said, and I've got some great rewards prepared for you and your family. Come on.
I can shout right there. But Abram replied, "O sovereign Lord, what good are all your blessings when I don't even have a son?"
Wow.
Mm-mm-mm. "Since you've given me no children, Eliezer of Damascus, a servant in my household, will inherit all my wealth. You have given me no descendants of my own, so one of my servants will be my heir." Then the Lord said to him, "No, your servant will not be your heir, for you will have a son of your own and will be an own who will be your heir."
Hold up. Yep. Wait a minute.
Come on.
Think about what we talked about last week. Think about what we discussed and shared last week. God told us to announce to the body of Christ, to announce to the families of the earth that it's birthing season. And here it is. God tells Abraham, he said, "Abraham, I'm about to birth something in you." Not just something, but new life.
Yeah.
God tells Abraham, "I will give you a son." Now you got to understand, Abraham and his wife Sarah, amen, was a family, but they didn't have any children, but yet they were still a family. 90 plus years old, they were almost 100 years old, and God was making them a promise that it was birthing season. And in the birthing season, it required something of Abraham. It required something of his wife Sarah. Guess what it required? It required faith. Huh? It required them to believe God. Come on, keep reading.
Then I'm going to go back to four. "Then the Lord said to him, 'No, your servant will not be your heir, for you will have a son of your own who will be your heir.' Then the Lord took Abram outside and said to him, 'Look up into the sky and count the stars if you can. That's how many descendants you will have.' And Abram believed the Lord, and the Lord counted him as righteous because of his faith."
Wow. The Bible says that Abraham believed God.
Yes.
He believed the Lord, and it was counted unto him as righteousness. Why? Because of his faith.
Because
think
his
about
faith.
The four pillars or the four highest powers that we've been sharing with you in regards to the kingdom of God. We have the highest power being the power of love.
Mm-hmm.
Then we have the power of grace. The power of forgiveness.
Yes.
And then we also said that there's this other power called faith. Abraham, he had to have faith in order to operate in the four highest powers. He had to have faith in order to be blessed, to be a blessing to all the nations of the earth. Without faith, amen, he could not have operated those powers.
Yes.
I like the way you said it the other week, Pastor Renee. You said that the pillars are like four legs to a chair. Or to a table. If you look at a table and you take one of the legs off, the table will not be able to hold up what it's designed to hold up.
Right.
The same way, amen, if you got love, if you got grace, and if you got forgiveness, but you have no faith, you still can't please God.
Yes.
Remember, Abraham was not of the law. He was of grace and faith. Abraham was a part of the kingdom of God's system before the law was ever established. And what we're seeing now is God making a promise to Abraham that I'm going to birth something new out of you, new life out of you. Don't just look at it as a just, okay, Abraham's getting a son. His name is going to be called Isaac. No, look at it as birthing season for you and your family, because what the Lord shared with us last week is that we are in birthing season in 2021. So the new life could be new opportunities, new things that God has prepared for you and your household that you have yet to realize or experience. It's birthing season, amen. It's birthing season. This was new to Abraham. All of these things were new to Abraham. He did not understand what God was saying fully. That's why he checked God by saying, do you mean my heir, Eliezer? Do you mean he's going to be the one that receives these blessings? Do you mean my servant Eliezer is going to be the one that, amen, will get the things that you have prepared for me? God said, no, it's going to be your son. Yes. You are in a position to birth out some things, Abraham. And I decree and declare over the people of God and the families of the earth that are connected to the body of Christ and to Jesus Christ today, you are in birthing season. Amen. It may not be a physical human being that you're getting ready to birth, but my God, it's a vision. It's a business. It's an opportunity. It's favor. It's promotion. It's whatever God has promised and prepared for you and your family. It is birthing season. And Abraham had a choice. He could have got on board or he could have jumped ship. But what did Abraham do? The Bible says, and Abraham believed the Lord. In verse 6. And it was counted to him as righteousness because of his faith. Will you believe the Lord today? Or will you look at me cross-eyed and cockeyed when I say it's birthing season? Abraham could have had a lot of doubt because of his age, but he chose to throw doubt out the window, to push doubt to the side, and he chose to believe and have faith. What will you do today? It may look impossible to you. The deck may be stacked against you. The odds may not be working in your favor. But if God has promised you vision for businesses and opportunities and advancement and promotion and financial moves and all of these things, if God has promised you things about your children, who are your seed, are you going to stop believing? Are you going to be like a man, Abraham, and dare to believe God, even though it may look in the natural like it won't come to pass? I remember Pastor Renee. 6 years ago in the spring, this spring makes 6 years ago, when God told you to go by 5535 Statesville Road. I remember it was the spring 6 years ago, and you called me on the phone. You were driving down 85, and you shared with me that God told you to go by this land, and this was the second time, because the first time you went by this land, the land was sold. So the second time God told you to go by, there was a for sale sign on the land. 6 years ago, all we had was a word. And my wife was driving down 85 southbound, going towards uptown Charlotte. And she called me on the phone, and God told her, turn off on Statesville Road and go back over to that property. And notice what happened. I had a choice to make. I could have, she called me. Watch this. She called me. I could have discouraged her. I could have said, keep on driving. We've already checked that property out. It's sold. It was sold. But I said, if God said it, go do it. You hear what I'm saying? If God said it, do it. And she did it. She went to that land not knowing what she would find. But when she pulled on that property, there was a for sale sign on that property. It was just her and I and God, just like it was just God and Abraham and Sarah. We were all having a conversation. But what God needed us to do was not doubt but have faith.
Yeah.
And what God needs you and your family to do is not doubt but have faith. And for those of you that don't know, you may say, well, what does that have to do with the family? Guess what? This land is now where God is building himself a house.
Yeah.
But he needed a seed.
Yeah.
He needed a seed. He needed a family. Hey, he needed a family that would catch the vision, that would believe by faith that although it looks impossible, that all things are possible through Christ who strengthens us. And we raise our hand and say, God will be that family. We'll be that husband and wife. We'll be that family that will believe that although it looks impossible, that you can make all things possible.
Yes.
Will you be that family today?
Yes.
Will you be that family that will separate yourself from all the other families?
Come on.
And say, God, if you promised it to us, we're going to receive it by faith.
Not
if
faith.
You promised it to us, we're going to believe it by faith.
Yes.
We will not doubt in our hearts.
Yes.
And right now, today, the foundation has been poured. That was over 6 years ago. The foundation has been poured. The building has come up out of the ground.
Yes.
They're about to put the roof on top of the building.
Hallelujah.
But it all started with faith, that seed of faith. Just like with Abraham.
Yes.
God birthed something great.
Yes.
Because of faith, we were heirs to a promise that we didn't even know we had.
Yes.
But when God showed us the promise, we did not deny it. We received it by faith.
Yes, by faith.
When God showed you the promise, this is why we're teaching you this today as kingdom families. When God showed you the promise, you cannot deny what God is showing you.
Yes.
You must believe it and receive it by faith.
Yes.
As families of the kingdom of God.
Yes.
Come on, Pastor Renee.
Amen. But before there could be a birthing, there had to be a breaking.
Ah, we said that last week, didn't we?
We said that last week.
Before there could be a birthing, there must be a breaking. Wow.
So there had to be a breaking in Abraham's family.
Yes.
Oh, my God. There's some good word right here. Genesis 13, 1 through 9.
Mm-hmm.
It says, so Abram left Egypt and went back to Negev, he and his wife and everything he owned, and Lot still with him. By now, Abram was very rich, loaded with cattle and silver and gold.
Wow.
He moved on from Negev, camping along the way to Bethel, the place he had first set up his tent between Bethel and Ai, and built his first altar. Abram prayed there to God. Lot, who was traveling with Abram, was also rich in sheep and cattle and tents. But the land couldn't support both of them.
Wow.
They had too many possessions.
So here's the thing. Remember, God made a promise to Abraham that he would have a son, but yet it had not fully manifested.
Yeah.
But God was telling Abraham, listen, you have your nephew Lot. You have family. You have all of this. Right now, you're wealthy and you're rich. Mm-hmm. You have great possessions. But read the next part.
They couldn't both live there.
Wow.
Quarrels broke out between Abram's shepherds and Lot's shepherds. The Canaanites and the Perizzites were also living on the land at the same time. That's crowded. Okay, next verse. Abram and said to Lot, let's not have fighting between us. Between your shepherds and my shepherds. After all, we're family. Look around. Isn't there plenty of land out there? Let's separate. If you go left, I'll go right.
Mm-hmm.
If you go right, I'll go left.
Wow.
So Abraham was rich spiritually as well as materially,
yes,
because he had a connection with God. He could hear from God. He had a relationship with God. So that's where the spiritual came in. But materially, he had gained so much. He had cattle. He had sheep. He had people that was traveling with him. He was a very rich man.
It's never God's desire for his families in the kingdom of God to struggle.
Yes.
Let me say that again. It's never God's desire for the families in the kingdom of God to struggle.
Come on. Yes.
If you flinch when the Bible says that Abraham is very rich, that means that you don't have faith to believe the promises.
My God.
Because God says that Abraham was rich because God made him rich.
Connection.
He made him rich, both spiritually and naturally.
Yes, yes.
Abraham abound in the blessings,
uh-huh,
both spiritually and naturally.
Yes.
But Abraham was wise enough to understand that he had to obey God. He had to make sure that his household or his family did not struggle. A lot of times when we are struggling financially in our lives is because our households are not in order.
Not in order.
Or we may have conflict in our homes that is unresolved.
Mm-hmm.
And so Abraham saw a conflict with his nephew Lot. And the conflict became so tense that they were fighting one with the other. This was family.
Yes.
But Abraham realized and recognized, first of all, I love my nephew Lot. I love Lot. And so as a result of his love for Lot and his desire to keep his household in order so that he could be blessed to be a blessing to all the nations of the earth, he said, I've got to pray and seek God for a strategy on how to bring order to my family.
Yes.
You cannot expect to operate in disorder in your household and expect the blessings, my God, to overflow in your family. It will not work.
It will not work.
Perhaps the reason why families are struggling is because families are out of order.
Uh-huh.
Or their households are out of order,
yes,
in one area or another. That's that check down we talked about. Abraham did his own check down, and he realized this thing has gone too far. How many of us are putting up with mess in our households,
wow,
when God is trying to tell you it's gone too far?
Yes, yes, yes.
Wow. Disrespectful children.
Mm.
Amen. All kind of foolishness we allow as kingdom families in our homes, these things ought not to be.
Yes, got to raise the standard.
We must absolutely raise the standard to God's righteousness.
Yes.
We need to raise the standard in our home to be in line with the standard of God's word.
Yes.
Because what you allow is what you, amen, agree with. See, if I allow certain things in my household, that means I'm in agreement with those things being in my house.
Yes.
Now, if you don't allow it, then guess what? You set a higher standard, and everybody in the house must fall in line. This is not, amen, opposite of love. This is love.
Uh-huh.
For the Bible says we ought to speak the truth in love.
That's right.
The Bible says, whom the Lord loveth, he corrects.
That's right.
Even as a father who loves his son. So we said in order to be a birthing, there must first be a breaking. Mm-hmm. Here's the breaking.
Yeah.
Before Abraham could receive the promise, amen, of the son and all that, there had to be a breaking. There had to be a breaking or a separation from the toxic relationship, mm-hmm, even in his own family.
Right.
It didn't mean that Abraham didn't love Lot.
Oh, yeah.
Come on.
That's right. It didn't mean he didn't love him.
Yeah.
But sometimes you got to separate yourself from those you love in order to keep the standard of God that he has commanded you to keep.
I know even in my own house, because I'm not throwing stones on nobody else's house. In my own house, mm-hmm, with my own son, mm-hmm, when things became toxic, I knew there had to be a separation.
Yes.
Didn't mean that I didn't love my son. I help my son and I support my son. I still do. Mm-hmm. But there had to be a separation.
Right.
And guess what? My wife and I had to come in agreement on that.
Yeah.
Because without agreement, guess what? The house is still jacked up.
Come on.
And out of order. Abraham had the blessing, but his household was out of order. See, that ought to tell us something.
Yeah.
That just because he was rich, he had material things, didn't mean he didn't have trouble in the house.
Come
but
on.
He understood, I got to be wise enough to deal with the trouble in my house. Mm-hmm. There was conflict and fighting going on, and he just didn't let it go. He just didn't sweep it under the rug. He just didn't say, oh, it'll be okay. It'll go away on its own. No, it festers. You got to deal with the issues.
Wow.
Oh, they don't want to hear from me now.
Yes.
There has to be a breaking.
You have to deal with it. You have to deal with it.
There has to be a breaking.
Yes.
There has to be a breaking. Now, when Abraham told Lot to leave and there was a separation, did he take stuff away from Lot? No.
In fact, he
told Lot, you pick where you want to go. Mm-hmm. And Lot chose the best part of the land. And guess what? Because Abraham loved Lot, he says, nephew, go get what you want. Mm-hmm. And guess what? If you read about Lot down in Sodom and Gomorrah, when all hell broke loose down there, it was Abraham, when the angels were coming to kill Lot.
Yeah.
Because he was involved with all kind of sin and disobedience and rebelliousness and wickedness that were going on in Sodom and Gomorrah. It was Abraham that begged God and said, would you spare the city for one family? Mm-hmm. And he was talking about his nephew Lot.
Yeah.
He said, would you spare the city for one family? And the death angel said, because of you, Abraham, yes, we will.
Connection.
Wow, look at the connection.
The connection.
So it was not about a love thing. It was about an order thing. Mm-hmm. And many of us, we allow the enemies to think that we can't make hard decisions when it comes to toxic relationships in family. Because if we do that, that means we don't love them. No. It means you do love them.
Yes.
You love them enough that you're not going to cause them or you, amen, to get out of godly character.
Yes.
Because it can have deadly repercussions. Mm-hmm. Think about how many families we read about that the husband kills the whole family, the wife and everybody. Mm-hmm. Or the wife kills her children, or the mother kills her children. Think about all, I'm talking about in the last year.
Yes.
These news reports are happening over and over again of these suicides in the last month because of toxicity in the house.
Because we don't know how to separate. We don't know how to remove ourselves. We keep telling ourselves it's going to get better. It's going to change. But God is saying move.
Even if we're not talking about a physical separation, even just a separation of time out.
Yes. Yeah.
You're having a heated argument. They were fighting. They were quarreling. There was great conflict. Conflict is not always bad. Sometimes conflict shows you the real issue, and you have to take a time out to pray, a time out to calm yourself down. Abraham did not experience peace in his home because of this conflict and this tension, this fighting.
Yes.
God, a part of the blessing is peace. Mm-hmm. Not your peace, not the peace that the world gives, but the peace that Jesus gives.
Yes.
Jesus said, my peace I give unto you. Not as the world gives, I give to you.
Yes.
Kingdom peace.
My God.
That's what Abraham was after, and that's what Abraham proceeded to do. Will we have the courage? When God says there's some things that need to be broken in our families, broken off of our families that are not like him, that are pulling the family down, will we have the courage to do what God says?
Wow.
Abraham had the courage to do what the Lord said.
Yes.
And separating himself from Lot for the sake of love and peace.
Yes.
Come on.
Okay, let's look at this next point. Whoa. It says, get your financial house in order.
Yes.
We already talked about the reason that Abraham was blessed so he could be a blessing to others. And us being blessed is not for our standard of giving to be raised, living to be raised, but our standard of giving to be raised.
Amen.
So we look at Genesis 14, 18 through 20 in the King James Version. It says this, "And Melchizedek, king of Salem, brought forth bread and wine, and he was the priest of the Most High God. And he blessed him and said, Blessed be Abram of the Most High God, possessor of heaven and earth. And blessed be the Most High God, which had delivered thy enemies into thy hands and gave him tithes of all."
Wow.
See, Abram had been in a battle. Mm-hmm. And when he had gotten in that battle, he was given the spoils of that battle, which made him even more rich. He became... he possessed all that he had gotten from the people he defeated. Yes. And so instead of him holding on to that and keeping it for himself, he went and paid tithes or gave tithes to Melchizedek, a kind of priest, just as Jesus is our high priest.
So you will never, here's a good point, you will never experience the fullness of God's promises.
Come on.
If your finances are in a wreck. If your financial house is in a wreck right now, then you will not experience the fullness of God's promises.
Wow.
That he made to you and your family through the promises that he made to Abraham. The tithe is the tenth. Abraham had the spoils. Mm-hmm. He had the goods.
He had the goods.
He could have left, and he said, and the Bible went on to say that he gave them to the other kings that fought with him, but yet from his portion, he said, I'm going to do what I believe God is leading me to do. Remember, this was before the law. The law had not manifested yet. Mm-hmm. Moses, the lawgiver, the Ten Commandments had not come to the earth. He said, I'm going to give to Melchizedek a tenth, a tithe. The tithe is the tenth of our earnings. Mm-hmm. And Melchizedek in the Old Testament was a type of Christ. He represented Jesus Christ in the Old Testament.
Yes.
And so when Abraham went to Melchizedek, Melchizedek conferred a blessing upon Abraham, and Abraham sold or gave a tenth of the spoils or the resources that he had received from the battle.
From the battle. Mm-hmm.
So if you're wrestling with tithing, amen, you're wrestling with the blessing.
My God.
If you're struggling with tithing, you're struggling with receiving the fullness of the blessing.
Wow.
The empowerment to prosper in every area, in every aspect of your life. Mm-hmm. Abraham had a choice. He could have kept it all for himself, but he chose not to because he believed in God. And he believed, my God, that I must do this to show God that I honor him. Wow. If we as families are going to truly honor God and get our households in order, our finances have to be in order as well.
That's right.
There's no way around it. Again, the check down, if you're struggling, the check down, if you're in conflict, the check down, if things are not working right, guess what? You need to check the things that are going on in your house.
Yes.
Not just the fighting and the arguing, not just, amen, the relationships you have with your children, but also your finances.
Yes.
This is a part of the check down. Mm-hmm. See yourself the way God sees you and your family.
Yes.
Notice what Jesus said in Matthew 6, 19 through 21. Come on.
It says, "Lay not up for yourselves treasures upon earth, where moth and rust doth corrupt, and where thieves break through and steal. But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust doth corrupt, and where thieves do not break through nor steal. For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also."
Wow.
So if you are developing a budget, trying to get your financial house in order, and the first thing that you don't put down is tithe, that's where your treasure is. Giving the tithe is not about just doing something ritually or religiously. It's about where your heart is. If your heart is toward God, then he is your treasure. And if he is your treasure, that's what you're going to put first. Mm. And everything else comes after that, because God will provide. The birds don't have to worry about where they're going to get food, because they know God is going to provide for them. We should know that God will provide for us, because he's Jehovah Jireh. He wants to see us do well. He wants to see us prosper. Why? Because we're Abraham's seed.
Yes.
He's already given us the promise. So why are we scratching our head trying to struggle how we're going to pay bills? Mm. When we're Abraham's seed, when he said that we're blessed to be a blessing, when we've got that connection, then we're going to be obedient to the total word of God.
Yes.
And the word of God says that we should give a tenth of our earnings.
But you mentioned another word, budget.
Yes, budget.
Budget. Budgeting. Amen.
Budgeting.
A budget is simply a financial plan.
A roadmap.
Or financial roadmap. Mm-hmm. Or financial picture for you and your family. And this is a saying that's not in the Bible, but I believe it has some merit here. If you fail to plan, you plan to fail.
Yes.
If you don't have a budget for you and your household, we highly encourage you today to start, amen, this week by developing a budget. If you do not know how to develop a budget, you can Google it.
Google.
There are a lot of things out there. Dave Ramsey, all Christian financial concepts, all kinds of information on the internet that shows you how to do a budget. If you need further assistance, we want you to go to our website. And on our website, amen, go to our contact page and say, we send us your information, say, I need help with a financial plan for my family. Because here's the deal. If you don't have a financial plan, you are failing. Even if you think you're not failing, you are failing because you're missing out on the fullness of the blessing.
Yes. Yeah.
Just because you're getting crumbs don't mean you're getting the cake.
Come on, I want the cake.
Oh, that went over somebody's head.
I want the cake.
We are so happy settling for the crumbs off the cake, mm-hmm, that a lot of us haven't even experienced the cake, because we are missing out on the blessings of obedience. Mm-hmm. Just because you say, well, I got enough to pay my bills. Well, that's your problem. The Bible says Abraham was very rich. Abraham didn't operate in the realm of enough. Uh-huh. He operated in the realm of more than enough.
Yeah. Yeah.
More than enough. Yeah. More than enough favor.
Yeah.
More than enough blessing.
Yeah.
More than enough peace.
Yeah.
More than enough finances. You still thinking about just getting enough. Just starting by. Just having enough to pay my rent. Just having enough to pay my car payment.
Yes. Yeah. And that's not the promise. That's not the promise. He said, I'm blessing you to be a blessing.
Right.
So how in the world are you going to bless others if you just doing enough?
Wow.
You scraping the bottom of the barrel. You just doing enough to pay that rent.
You can't even bless yourself, more or less bless somebody else.
Yes.
Because God said, I called you to be Abraham's seed.
Yes.
And you are blessed to be a blessing.
Yes.
To all the
Yes.
families of the earth.
Yes.
We forget that part. We just say, oh, I got enough for me to pay my rent, my car payment, my light bill, my water bill, my this, my that. But it's more than that.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
If you're Abraham's seed, it's more than that.
Yes. Yes.
And the Bible says if you belong to Jesus and you're Abraham's seed,
mm-hmm,
if you have a relationship with Jesus Christ and you're Abraham's seed, that means that you are blessed to be a blessing.
Blessing.
That means overflow.
Yes, overflow.
Overflow for your families.
Yes.
So if you're not operating in the overflow,
my God,
you don't have to make six figures to operate in overflow. You can make $30,000 a year and operate in the overflow.
Yes.
I want to give you something. I was, when I first got saved, there were three things that I learned. I learned about the love of God. I learned how to be obedient and faithful to God. And I learned about tithing. And early on, when I was making $17,000 a year,
ooh, my God,
which in today's standards not enough, and even back then it was not. I had an apartment. I had bills. I had student loans. And I was holding it down as a single man at $17,500 a year. Why? Because I learned early on how to get my financial house in order. And as Jesus said, where your heart is, there will your treasures be also. I would always make sure that I had a yearly budget for me as a single, not married. And the first thing on my budget was not my rent or my car payment. It was the tithe. So if I made $17,500 a year, that was $1,750 that went into the kingdom every year. Mm-hmm. But it wasn't long, Pastor Renee. Mm-hmm. It wasn't long that $17,500 doubled. Within a matter of 5 years or less, it doubled. My income went from 17-something to 30-something. In other words, amen, as I began to obey the principles, and because I was consistent in the tithing and the financial plan, I was able to be blessed, and more was added to me to be a blessing. So maybe not right now today. You say, well, I can't be a blessing. Well, get your household in order so you can be a blessing.
Yes.
Don't hide behind the excuse that you can't be a blessing. Do something so you can be a blessing.
That's it. Get on the journey.
Do something for you and your family. Do yourself a favor and tap into the kingdom blessings.
Yes.
Tap into the overflow.
Tap into it, connect.
Don't allow your treasures of material things to take over your heart.
Yeah.
Don't allow the treasures of cars and houses and clothes and Netflix and eating out to take over your heart. Mm-hmm. And you say you love God.
Yeah.
Do your family a favor. And today, start a financial plan.
Yes.
For your future.
For your future.
We want you to do that. Yes. God desires for you to be blessed, to be a blessing.
To be a blessing.
Yes. Amen. Well, that concludes it. Amen.
Amen.
Can we give the Lord praise in the house of God and even out on Facebook Live?
Yes.
We have covered a lot of ground today as we conclude this teaching on kingdom families. I mean, we have touched on so many things. If you haven't been a part of the whole series, you can go to our website, and we have all of the YouTube videos out there where you can go back and see series 1 through series 4. This is our final series. Pastor Renee, it has been a blast. Amen. Let's give Pastor Renee a hand for it. It has been a blast co-laboring with you in this series.
Yes.
I'm so honored that you are my, amen, ride or die. Mm. And I'm just so thankful for how God uses you in so many ways in our family.
Amen.
And we're just so thankful for each and every one of your families today. And we pray that every word that has been spoken over your life has started to change mindsets.
Yes.
To where you are seeing yourself the way God sees you. Amen. As kingdom families, it's important that you see yourself the way the Lord sees you. And if you are not a part of the family of God, even as we read in the book of Galatians chapter 3, Jesus died so that all the families of the earth could be blessed. Amen. And he wants you to be a part of God's family today. He died on Calvary's cross for you to be a part of God's family. And the way you connect, the way you get that membership card like we talked about earlier, is by receiving Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior. If that's your desire today, you say, Pastor Anthony, I pray and I'm ready to receive Jesus as my personal Lord and Savior. I want you to pray this prayer after me. Dear God, I believe that you sent your son, Jesus Christ, to die on Calvary's cross for my sins. And I ask you now, to forgive me of my sins, to cleanse me of all unrighteousness. Jesus, I invite you into my life right now to be my personal Lord and Savior. If you prayed that simple prayer, we want you to know that the Bible says, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. And with the mouth, as you confess out of your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you are saved. You are born again. Now we ask you to go to our website to let us know who you are by going to our contact tab, sending us your information so that we can disciple you and get information to you to help you on your new journey in the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, secondly, if you desire to give today, and I pray that that's all of us, amen, whether we are in live service or whether we are watching virtually on today, the Bible tells us that Abraham gave a tenth, a tithe, 10% of what he had taken in. And that's what the Lord requires of us as kingdom families. He requires the tenth. And if you desire today, amen, to take heed to the word of God, and I pray that you do, because you love God and God loves you, we want to give you that opportunity to give. There's three ways to give. Look at what's on your screen. You can give live in our live service. You can give online going to our website, clicking on Give Now. And you can also give by mailing in your gift to our P.O. Box number. So we have three ways to give on today, because we want you and your family to be blessed as God promised Abraham. So he is promising you today. And I believe we have a special treat for you right now. So take a listen and watch what is being on the screen at this particular time.
Greetings, everyone. I'm Pastor Anthony Williams with the Love Fellowship Church Charlotte, and I'm just so excited to share with you some of the progress that we're making on God's ground. God's kingdom property is coming to pass, and we're just so grateful and so thankful for the opportunity for you and your family to be a part and connect with what God is doing. So let's take a look inside of God's kingdom property. God has called Love Fellowship Church to build him a house for his glory, for his honor, and for the saving of lost souls. And that is exactly what we're doing. This is 5+ years in the making. And we're grateful and we're thankful, amen, for the vision that God has given us. For the Bible tells us, without vision, the people perish. But we know that with vision, great things can happen and manifest in our lives. So we're on the inside. We're in the interior of the property right now. And this is the fellowship hall on this side. We have classrooms for the youth, the children, the teenagers. We have opportunities for singles to gather. Oh, it's going to be a great time in the Lord. In the midst of a pandemic, God is birthing great things in the earth realm. This foundation that we're standing on right now, it is a sure foundation. It is a firm foundation in the Lord. And we want to invite you and your family to be a part of what God is doing here at Love Fellowship Church. We're located currently at 2817 West Sugar Creek Road in the beautiful Queen City of Charlotte. But I promise you, over the next several months, we're going to be transitioning to this 4 acres of land and the building that God is birthing in the earth realm. We also want to invite you to come to visit our website at lovefellowshipchurchcharlotte.org. That'll give you service times, information, what we have going on right now for you to connect with you and your family. Again, we thank you for partnering with us. We thank you for praying for us. We thank you for being a part of God's kingdom vision as God births his kingdom property in the earth in the midst of a pandemic. Look at what the Lord is doing. It is marvelous in our eyes. God bless you. Until next time, we love you with the love of Jesus Christ.
If you desire to connect with Love Fellowship Church, in membership. We also want you to do so. We are doing great and mighty things for the Lord as God has given us vision to do so. And we want you to connect, you and your families, with Love Fellowship Church. We invite you to become an e-member, or you can come and join this ministry, this local body of believers, this local family of believers, live and live service at 2817 West Sugar Creek Road. If you desire to become an e-member, go to our website, click on the membership tab and all the information, put it in there, and we will get information back to you. We are on the move for Jesus, advancing his kingdom. For his glory, for his honor, and for the saving of lost souls. And we want you to be a part of all that the Lord is doing in the earth in 2021. Well, God bless you. We love you. And may heaven continue to smile graciously upon you. Bye-bye.